our opening song, Glory and Praise to Our God.
We adore you. who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, Cyrus, whose right hand I grasp, subduing nations before him, and making him kings run in his service, opening doors before him and leaving the gates unbarred. For the sake of Jacob, my servant of Israel, my chosen one, I have called you by your name, giving you a title, though you knew me not. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. It is I who arm you, though you know me not, so that toward the rising and the setting of the sun, people may know that there is none besides me. I am the Lord. There is no other. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Thessalonians, and God the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, remembering you in our prayers, unceasingly calling to mind your work of faith and labor of love and endurance in hope of our Lord Jesus Christ before our God and Father, knowing, brothers and sisters loved by God, how you were chosen. For our gospel did not come to you in word alone, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with much conviction. The word of the Lord.
Restore them is not someone who is a descendant of King David. Rather, it is King Cyrus, the king of Persia. And it's a curious note because here we have King Cyrus, who he himself had not been part of the covenant relationship between God and his people, and yet God chooses to work through him. Now, imagine if the people had said, no, absolutely not, we will not accept your help. Well, looking back now, we would say that would be kind of the equivalency of biting your nose to spite your face. In other words, you have an opportunity to be restored, you have an opportunity to have things made right again, but because it didn't fit into the plan that you had or your own designs, you end up causing more harm for yourself in the long run, just to make a point. Likewise, in our gospel reading for today, we also have the relationship between the people of Israel as well as another government that is described in today's gospel reading, although in this case the context is different. Now, in this case, it isn't about King Cyrus helping the Israelites by conquering the Babylonian Empire and by allowing the Israelites to go back to the Holy Land. Instead, this becomes a discussion, or really in some ways, kind of a heated debate between the Herodians and the Pharisees and Jesus. And so the question I ask is loaded with meaning. For instance, the idea of the Israelites having this coin that would have the picture of Caesar on it was actually somewhat scandalous for a lot of reasons. It was scandalous because it represented the foreign occupation of Israel. It was also scandalous, too, because Caesar enjoyed divine-like status, and so therefore, for someone who worshiped a true God, the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham, the God of Jacob, the God of Isaac, to be carrying around a coin that had the image of someone who was considered to be like a God, or to have God-like sense of reverence amongst his own followers, that would have been a source of idolatry. It kind of would have. And so therefore Jesus is being tasked to say, yes, it's okay to commit idolatry, or at least that's the intention behind the question. But then again, like a perfect catch-22 situation, if Jesus says, well, no, it's not, you don't have to pay the tax, then what do you do? Then if he says don't pay the tax, then it means that that the people of Israel could be perhaps attacked by the Roman Empire. And in fact, later on they would be, in around the year 70 AD, they actually would be, and the Second Temple would be destroyed. And so for Jesus, though, his answer is brilliant in its simplicity, and there are so many layers that we can take away from it for today. He asked them, whose image is this and whose inscription? When they reply, Caesar, he says, then repeat to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God. Now, Caesar today might represent our federal government, it might represent our civic duties. So yes, we do have a sense of duty to one another as citizens of the United States of America. We pay our taxes in the hopes so that the taxes are being used to pay for the salaries of civic leaders who will look out for us and look out for one another, to provide us with the amenities and the things that we need, such as having roads and bridges for cars to drive on, having the emergency services we need, police departments, fire departments, schools, things of that nature. We may not necessarily enjoy paying taxes. Probably don't. Most people don't. I certainly don't. But we also see that, at least to a certain extent, taxes are inevitable, and we do need at least some of them, because without them, our society, as we know it, would collapse around us. And it would turn into anarchy.
without the ability for us to be able to have local government services that help to provide for our daily needs. Likewise, though, we can also see that what belongs to God is our very self, the very best of ourselves. To quote from the great Shema from the book of Deuteronomy, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and as Jesus adds, to love your neighbor as you love yourself. The two are not separated, but rather they are combined. And to love God also means to love your brother or sister. Doesn't mean you're always going to get along. It doesn't mean that. And certainly, we'll be foolish to think, especially in these divisive days, that tomorrow morning we could somehow wake up and everyone would say, you know what? Let's put aside some of these petty differences. Let's put aside the unnecessary need to draw a line in the sand and say, you have to believe either this way, and if you don't, it means you're somehow the enemy. Unfortunately, that's not going to happen. We realize that it's just how it is. But what we can do is look for the good in one another. What we can do is to look to and see the blessings that our brothers and sisters truly are for us. Consider what St. Paul says in our second reading for today, taken from his first letter to the Thessalonians. He gives thanks to God always for all of them, remembering them in his prayers. Likewise, I am very grateful to the many people who are a blessing to me. I'm very grateful for my family, very grateful for friends who I've met along the way from elementary school, Jefferson Elementary School, Shawmont Middle School, High School, Siena College, the formation program for priestly formation for the Diocese of Albany, as well as all the parishes that I have been blessed to serve at. I also, like many other people, have to remind myself that yes, along the way, there will be times when we feel discouraged. There will be times when perhaps I, and maybe you too, feel like we focus only on those situations where we had disagreements with people, where we found there were maybe some people who perhaps could have been more charitable with their words, could have been a little bit more open-minded, could have maybe been a little kinder. But at the same time, thankfully, God provided to St. Paul kind people to be a blessing to him. Likewise, I am very blessed. I'm grateful for that. And hopefully, all of us, when we stop and stop for a moment to really look beyond those hurts that can really bother us, we look beyond our frustrations, we look beyond sometimes what even might be a rather jaded outlook on life, we see that yes, there are people out there who are blessings to us. And when we keep an open mind about whom God may send to us as a blessing, we really help ourselves in the end. Rather than symbolically bite our noses to spite our faces, what I mean by that is to really close ourselves off to the possibilities that God may have in store for us, and to stubbornly think, it's gotta be my way, it's gotta be my way or the highway, and it's gotta be according to my vision. Rather than do that, may we be open to God's plan for us. May we be open to whom God is sending to us, and not be too close-minded. And so again, this is not something that is easy to integrate overnight. We might have to remind ourselves again and again that yes, God has brought people into our lives for a purpose. They are not there by happenstance. And yes, we do have blessings to be able to reflect upon and be grateful for. It is not necessarily always the easiest to think like that, particularly during these difficult days where it seems natural and normal to may be harp and obsessed over the things or the people that bother us, but we also can see that the beauty and the blessings that come when we take inventory of the many ways that God has been good to us, and likewise the ways that we can certainly give the best of ourselves to God, because as Jesus says, repay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God.
Together, let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, come from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father, through whom all things are made, for us and for our salvation, in him down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate with the Virgin Mary, became man. For our sake he was crucified in the Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He is ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will not be ruined. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who lived with the Father and the Son into the door of the world of God, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so at this time, we now present these petitions before our God.
Strengthened and edified by the prayers of the church throughout the world. Let us sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
That all leaders of state may be guided by the Almighty in the just use of power. Let us sing to the Lord.
Hear us,
sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
That Christ may have a place in our hearts and homes of those gathered here, let us sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may rest eternally in peace. Let us sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
We pray these prayers through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
Please join us in singing our offertory song, Shelter Me, O God.
Shelter me, O God, I need it, the shadow of your wings.
sinners, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying action of your grace, may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life. And by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. The mystery of faith. Mary, Mother of God, will to Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you, your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give to this present age, and prepare for the gifts that are eternal, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Again, thank you for joining us for Mass today. Certainly wish all of you a very blessed and rest of the day today, a very blessed weekend. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks
be to God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And to the Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Did you hear about the cobra that hid in the tuba? Did you hear about the cobra that hid in the tuba? He was a real snake in the brass.
Get it? No. Snake in the grass. Snake in the grass.